12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 9 more days. And it's cold here. Alaskan storm came through. And it's going to be very, very cold up in the North Bay. So I'm all bundled up. The days have been up and down, up and down. I've had a couple days ago, had an absolutely colossal day that is indescribable as far as clarity goes, as far as seeing through the matrix, feeling like I'd actually seen through it, through and through, like a victory, as it were. And then thinking, okay, what's next? What's going to happen next? That's the question, isn't it? Always. There's never a dull moment on the path. Because you never know. It's just incredible. And what you see, the perspectives you have, is just like rocking your world. You just see how trapped you were and how deluded you were and how this whole play is so completely diluted. I know in the non-dual traditions, it's very traditional to say that this is all the play of Brahman, all of God's play, and God is just playing this game, a sport, sporting with himself. It's not true. I don't know why they say that, but it simply is not so. This is a hypothetical scenario that we, Spirit, is engaging with to come up with a preemptive cure for the problem of annihilation, which it believes is going to happen to reality. And God knows there's no such thing as annihilation. God is not playing this game at all. So I differ, starkly differ from the non-dual traditions as far as this explanation goes. Is why is this crazy illusion game? Ananda Mayama used to say, God is playing a completely insane game. This is all completely insane. But remember, in the Hindu traditions and as in Christian traditions, there's God, which is an Hindu Brahman, and in Christian traditions they call Jesus as God, and then there's the Father God, which in Hindu traditions is Parabrahman, and in Christian traditions is God the Father, and they're not the same. They're not the same. It is Brahman that is playing this game, that is crazy game. It is God the Son that is playing this crazy game. It is not God the Father. It's not the prime creator that's playing this game at all. That's super important. So I come at the whole position from a completely opposite direction of the non-dual teachings, completely opposite. So when I listen to what they're saying, I hear what they're saying, but the emphasis for me is all out of whack as far as the way I look at it. I look at it from the top down. What is this game? What is this delusion? What is this play, Maya? Where did it come from? What gave rise to it? That's all important to me. I don't care about the self, consciousness, awareness, all this non-dual stuff. I just brush it aside. It doesn't really matter to me at all. And a couple days ago, I was able to see through the whole situation crystal clear. And it had nothing to do with the traditional non-dual teachings at all. And yet those teachings can arrive at the same place. They can, and they have for some. They arrive at the same place, but the way they talk about it is very different. Coming at it from two sides, opposite directions almost, arriving at the same place. But I cannot really teach in the traditional non-dual way. It's not possible for me. And whenever I try to do that, I feel stalling out, and I lose my track, and then I get back on track, and then for me, the clarity just humming. Just wow, you can see the entire picture of it all, and it for me, it doesn't, the idea like consciousness, all those things, doesn't matter. It's what is this whole situation anyway? It's a hypothetical scenario designed to try and get us to survive annihilation, the annihilation of reality. And whatever it is that survived, the reason why the non-dual teachings stumble at some point is because they, unless you understand this is a hypothetical scenario, you can't really explain what this I is, because it's a hypothetical I. It's an I that we're trying, in the making, that we believe will survive annihilation. It'll be the remedy for annihilation. So putting this in the right context, everything suddenly gets crystal clear. But it's a little, even for me, it's a little unexpected. When this clarity came a couple of days ago, it was so profound. I was fine, but I just said, wow, it's really there. It really is there. The clarity really is there. The whole ball of wax is right there. And this way really does work. On the same hand, I felt like, gosh, how in the world can I explain this to anybody? Because it does, I couldn't put it in the traditional non-dual context. I could not. Just could not. Because it seems like what's apples and oranges as far as conceptually, verbally talking about it. And so, how could I explain it to anybody? Because everybody's expecting enlightenment to come from a non-dual perspective. And I cannot explain it that way at all. So anyway, I have to keep going on the way that I have pioneered, that Ramana Maharshi came to me in a dream, it was a vivid, very vivid dream, different type of dream, and said, keep on working what you're doing. It'll pay off in the long run, but not immediately. People won't understand what you're saying. He said, I said, look at all those people following you, and they understand what you're saying. He said, yeah, that's great. I'm happy for that. He said, and I said, there's nobody's listening to what I'm saying. Nobody's following it. They can't follow it. And he said, don't worry. He says, I can follow it perfectly well. And eventually it will pay off big time. And it is true. I just don't know when. But there's no question that seeing it the way that I've been able to describe it and the way I see it is actually a super elegant way of looking at it. And at some point, it will become the classical way, the way that is most streamlined and elegant. And when people approach it in this direction and grasp just how easier this makes it all, it clears up so many troubles that we don't quite recognize. It will catch on at some point, and become a very powerful tool to awaken. When you look at it from the etiology of it, the origin of all of this, and get everything lined up properly, what we know, God and God the Son, it's in the prime creator and the prime created, and what the prime created wanted to be prime creator, gave rise to the desire to experience, find a way to do this. And that desire would be to change reality, desire to change reality. And that immediately gave rise to the fear of annihilation, because reality cannot be changed. And if it were, it would all be annihilated. So that fear of annihilation coming from this desire, it gave rise to this hypothetical scenario, which gave rise to what is called consciousness and the false self and all this stuff, the ego, these various terms. They're all kind of rootless in the traditional explanations. It doesn't provide the context in which to see them very clearly, what's going on. It just does not. Almost every non-dual teacher I've come across brushes aside this question, and the people ask them, well, why did God do this? And they'll say, well, we'll have to ask God. Or it's just a play. God just enjoyed all this diversity, sporting with itself, hiding from itself. Or these answers are not good answers, and they don't really round it out and give just rock solid clarity. They don't. They simply don't. Which is why I've spent my whole life trying to come up with this, because I recognized right from the get-go, because I was studying non-dual teaching right from the get-go, and I said, hey, there is a big stumbling block there, and some have managed to arrive at the realization, but most have not. And I'm concerned with everybody getting it. There has to be a way for more and more people to get it. And the non-dual way, it really is difficult. It is difficult. It's not wrong about its ultimate conclusion. Ramana, no, he's absolutely right about the ultimate conclusion. Abide as the self, abide in the overlay, abide in accepting reality as it is. But how is it that this universe arose in the first place? And all those things are profound confusions on the path that just, I mean, cause enormous struggles and cause people to settle for something that is not true liberation from this awful veil of suffering and tears and dying, etc. And so the clarity I had, the whole thing just became clarified down to a staggering extent. And I'm fine, everything's great. But how to teach this, I don't know. I really don't know. I can't seem to make any headway teaching it at all. direct transmission of just pure reassurance is the best, that accepting reality as it is perfectly fine. But what people don't grasp is this universe is not reality. It has absolutely nothing to do with reality. Nothing to do with it. You cannot get even a shred of clarity about what reality is all about by taking this universe to be real, or getting gleaning anything from this universe. You cannot get anything from this universe about reality. Cannot. You absolutely cannot. You have to go beyond belief. The entire resolution is beyond belief. And therein lies the problem. But that has to be pointed out. Absolutely, the resolution is beyond belief. And belief made words, belief made concepts, all this stuff. And so words only go so far. The best that words can do is simply point. But the pointing is very deceptive. I think Robert Adams said something about that, about how words absolutely just bring up a ton of problems, which is true. They really do. They really do. And yet, the words used properly can be brought to point out their own limitations. They can point out how it's necessary to go beyond words. The words can do that. But as far as pointing to the answer is total. And so a pointing in itself is misleading, because it infers a limitation. It's something that belief can believe in, a pointing to the moons or pointing to something. There's an assumption of limitation, and there is no limitation to truth, to what we are going towards accepting. And the entire language, you have to be hearing it from a perspective beyond belief. Otherwise, it's not going to work for you. It will not work. So you have to have some sort of grounding in that which is beyond belief, which is everything, which is reality, which is truth. You have to have some, be grounded in that before words can really work for you. Otherwise, they're going to paint a false picture and lead you into that false picture, and it's going to become troublesome. And the grounding in that which is beyond belief cannot be adequately described in words. It comes from certain experiences you have, peak moments, you come across that which is beyond belief, and you feel the reassurance of that, and it leaves a lasting impression in you, and then you know that there is something beyond belief. You know it. And so from that knowing, you know you're deluded. And from that knowing that you're deluded, you're able to listen to words and don't get caught up in trying to draw conclusions that belief can agree with. It's a fine art. Really, the path is a fine art that cannot be marketed, cannot be captured, cannot be taught. It's about your own determination, and a lot of times coming from your suffering. It cannot be an intellectual determination to solve a riddle or a problem, like a mathematical problem. Otherwise, you can't have these breakthroughs of clarification that are simply so encompassing. You just sit there and just go, okay, oh wow. Oh my gosh, so that's what belief has been doing. All of it. And you just notice, you say, okay. And you don't do anything about it. You don't try to figure it out or fix it. You just notice it. And you say, okay. You say, I'm okay with that. I can accept that. That's basically the key to the path is simply this feeling, say, I can accept that. Not intellectually. Not like, okay, how do I say this? But I can accept that. That's acceptable. Even though I see, holy cow, I have truly been trapped in a horrible situation. So I can accept that I've been trapped, that I've been in this incredibly malevolent scenario of existence. Existence is really absolutely psychopathic, 100%. And you're seeing that, you can just say, okay, I'm okay with that existence being That's what it is. I'm okay with that. How do you do that if you're not grounded in something greater? Oftentimes, I've had dreams where I'm just sobbing uncontrollably, just expressing intense grief and sadness and suffering, just letting it out, just absolutely crying, sobbing to an extreme depth of a release of this incredible, horrible suffering. And oftentimes I come across like an ambassador of certitude at such times who are there, and I see them, and somehow maybe they're helping trigger this release of just the pain and misery. Existence is horrible beyond any description, possible description, and yet you can see it, that it is that way, and you can be okay with it. You have to be. You have to say, that, okay, I accept it, and not try to fix it. That is the key. As soon as you try to fix it, you're lost, and you're back in the realm of belief. Because, of course, the entire thing is to try and fix it, to try and survive it. That is belief. Try to survive annihilation. So it just keeps hitting you with pain and misery and suffering. For as long as you are entertaining this hypothetical scenario, you will be hit with pain and suffering and misery and threat and death. And so there is no way around that whatsoever. And you see that. I saw that. I saw it. Clear as a bell. And I just saw that is what it is. No question about it. So the only answer is to drop it, to gravitate on the path of accepting reality as it is, and accepting the grace of God to replace this horrible illusion, horrible hypothetical, with the hypothetical of forgiveness, as one way to put it, which is then doesn't give rise to any other illusions, any threat. There's no threat to it. You forgive yourself for engaging in this hypothetical. That's one way of putting it. That's the way A Course in Miracles puts it. But as far as explanations go, the best explanation I've ever come across is A Course in Miracles. I read like a couple pages today, and it was just like completely spot on. I understood it just to a T. Just sip, 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 sip. Just seemed absolutely clear as a bell. And it is a super, super explanation. If you're talking about getting a conceptual explanation of it, it is an incredibly accurate explanation. Not that I understand all of it clear as a bell. There's still some areas that it's just a matter of style and emphasis. You're not going to always agree with all style and all emphasis, etc. But the clarification is there. Absolutely is there. So there's several ways. One is direct transmission of reassurance, which is what the guru should do. The other is a curriculum of explanation, which is what A Course in Miracles does that extremely well, extraordinarily well. And looking back, when I'm through with this horrible, ghastly scenario, hypothetical scenario, I will definitely give credit to A Course in Miracles. As far as what do I give credit to? Paramount credit to getting free, waking up from this, it will be A Course in Miracles. I asked myself that question yesterday, and the answer was obvious, without question. It won't be Anandamaya Ma, it won't be Ramana Maharshi, it won't be any other guru or whatever, it'll be A Course in Miracles, because it did an absolutely stellar job, magnificent job of using words to help us out, because we were so bound up in words. Certainly, there have been got a lot of other help too, but paramount from the standpoint of really giving me what I could sink my teeth into and utilize. Yeah, that's it. It won't be the non-dual teachers. It won't be that. No, that's not what did it for me. But I appreciate what they've done for sure, because they help us establish a culture. A subculture of asadhana, of spiritual work, of all of that. So that's super, super important. The whole thing is important. It all works together. But you're bound to find something that is paramount of importance, that puts you over the top, that's going to get it done for you. When I came across A Course in Miracles, I said, I had this intuitive knowing. I said, this is going to do it for me. I know that I'm going to succeed now, and I was sure of it. I had this sense of certainty that this is going, I'm going to succeed, and I'm going to free myself from this horrible hell that I seem to be trapped in. And it looks more and more like that's going to happen. I don't know how, I don't even know how I'm not free right now. After the insights I was having, I said, holy cow, it's like pulling a loose tooth. You don't know how the tooth is still there. Is it hanging on to some threads, or did you pull it out? I don't know. Got too much Novocaine to know if it's out or not. But it really just said, wow, that's curtains for belief, for delusion. It's just curtains. I just pushed through it and just saw the whole thing. Says, holy cow. So I don't know what's next. Really don't know. Hopefully it's some really miraculous stuff, because at some point you make the call and you accept the grace of God to replace the situation. Because the situation that we place ourselves in here, and phew, holy cow, do we make mistakes. I'm telling you. I saw my mistakes, and they're just horrendous mistakes. And just accepting the mistake, okay, yeah, that's what you expect. That's what belief guides you to do. Belief is just a complete maniac. Complete maniac. And it guides you in such horrendously terrible ways. And just seeing that, I just saw it, and I didn't say, okay, you don't need to do anything about it. Just notice it clearly, see it clearly, and accept it as it is. Just accept it as it is. That's all I did. That's all you have to do. Just accept what you see as it is. And that's the most powerful magnet you can have. Most powerful magnet. Don't worry about, okay, what do I need to do? Do I need to write a book about this or whatever? No, just accept it as it is. Say, okay, I see that. Wow, what a mistake. Whoa, just, holy cow, I did that, and I did that, and I did that. And the entirety of what I was doing was simply taking on more and more problems, more and more problems. I took on all the problems of the world because I wanted to be free. I wanted to be finished all this up. And belief said, okay, there's a way to do it, but you have to solve all the problems of the world. And I said, whatever it takes, I'll do it. And I took on all that problems and just, you know, pulled me down into this horrible black hole and so many terrible mistakes. Everything was just a gross, grotesque mistake. And just seeing it now, you see it, and you say, oh, okay, I accept that as it is. I accept it because I know that there is truth is beyond belief, and that's perfectly fine. It's like the whole thing's been vetted, and it's lost its grip. It's lost its hold. It may be a situation where the fan is still turning, but I turned it off, but it's still going around. So I feel the same as ever, but it seems as though I got to a point, maybe it's a dimmer switch, where I really turned it down, but it's just habit. I feel exactly the same as ever, with a lot of stress and nervousness, etc., about the future, what's coming up, and how to deal with the situation, how to be most helpful, which is paramount. But how do you get to the point where you're able to admit that everything you've ever done in existence has just been a grotesque mistake? And you truly see it. It's not just a theory. It's a fact. You see it as fact. Not just concept. It's easy to say, oh, I'm a sinner, or I've sinned, as a concept, as a general diffuse concept. But to literally see specifically how you were just led down into most incredibly terrible situations, and you're wondering, how come God's grace didn't help me? It's because we didn't allow it to. I didn't allow it to. I'm still not allowing it sufficiently, although I'm kind of on the edge of allowing it to happen. And when it happens, I'll probably start going to be very profound help I'm going to receive. I already started receiving a little trickle of it. What you essentially do, you say, I don't need any problems. I don't need to solve any problems. Therefore, I don't need any problems. And I saw that. I don't need the problem of the universe. I don't need the problem of the world. I don't need the problem of a body. I don't need the problem of scarcity. I don't need any problems. And I literally saw the grace of God can take care of everything for us if we simply allow it to. It's like there's a vast gold pile of gold, and here we are desperately digging for nuggets and using sluice boxes Yukon gold using sluice boxes and the hard work of getting a little bit of gold dust there. And we're desperately struggling. And yet here's a mountain of gold just right sitting right there for us. And we don't touch it. We don't touch it. It's stupid. It's crazy. And that we're all doing that. Because why we want to, we believe we that solving the problem of annihilation is going to give us some kind of extra boon. And once we solve it, then we can go back to reality, and then we can be at peace, because we'll say, well, even if reality is annihilated, we have this contingency plan all set up, so we'll be able to survive the annihilation. And that is why we continue to do it, and we don't want God interfering with it, and God won't interfere. God will not interfere. The spiritual path is so strange, because it just doesn't go the way you think that it should. It doesn't. I can't make heads or tails of it, tell you the truth, as far. I don't think anyone can. You never know what's going to happen next. It seems like it just very windy road, up and down, roller coaster windy road, and around every bend it's like, what? I didn't expect that. And because we don't realize how desperately addicted we are to trying to solve problems, and how we call problems into our lives. We literally do that. For instance, if you have cancer, whatever problem you have, I mean, if you have a health problem, you have it because you're working on trying to solve that problem. You're trying to solve it. It represents annihilation to you in some form. And you're trying to say, okay, let me overcome this problem. And we think that overcoming is like a miracle, it's God's grace. No, it's not. It's not. That is not God's grace. God's grace is to not have the problem in the first place. It's to drop the problem without any resolution. That's why they say submit is to give up all your solutions to problems. Drop them. Because with God there are no problems. In God's grace there are no problems. So there's no resolution to any problems. You don't make illusions real and then solve them. You don't make annihilation a real problem and then come up with a solution for it. That is the path of insanity. What is to say is it was never real. It never will be real. I don't need to have any answers at all. I have one answer to all questions, and that is you don't need any answers. I have one resolution to all problems is you don't need any resolution to any problems. If you have you need a very keen mind to get this, very keen mind, which is beyond belief. You have to be coming from a place beyond belief in your willingness to hear, to get this. And it's not a joke. It's not trying to be sarcastic or flippant or anything like that. It is the absolute truth. How do you solve problems? You don't. You don't need to. You don't solve any problems. You give up your problem-solvingness. Now, the fear is, of course, when you do that, is you will start sinking down. Your status in society will start sinking down. And I can address this directly right now, which is, that's exactly what happens. Previous life, I had a very high status in civilization and society. And previous to that, I also had times of very high status. And the previous life was exceptionally high. And I felt like I was, you know, at a pinnacle as far as status goes. And so coming into this life, I expected to maintain my high status. But in taking on all the problems of the world, I became overwhelmed. And then in the spiritual path beginning for me, I started to relinquish that which most people find most important, which is success in solving problems. And I started to just consider the entirety of the situation and just notice and accept what I was noticing as is. And so when you do that, you don't become a problem solver anymore, and you start to lose your ability to solve problems in the world, to be quote unquote successful. You really do. And so I kept sinking and sinking and sinking farther and farther down. Now, right now I'm at the bottom, really, of status. The bottom. Most people don't realize it, but tacitly I am related to as if I'm on the bottom, because I am. Because I'm really not capable of solving any problems in the world, hardly at all. Because I'm at the brink of giving up the entire problem-solving apparatus and effort and endeavor. and even the motivation and which is problems coming to me, and exchanging it for grace, for the grace of God, making that exchange. At that point, I won't have any problems. At that point, people will simply think that I'm an incredibly fortunate person. It's just unbelievably fortunate, and they won't understand how in the world could I possibly be so fortunate. How could I go from the outhouse to the penthouse just like that overnight? How is it possible? How could someone that seemed to be in the most incredible dead end, which I am in right now, which is what happens to low status people, they get caught in a complete dead end. How could I go from that to just incredible status and good fortune and just like a blessed life, and a totally blessed life? And the belief can't understand it. It's beyond belief. God's grace is beyond belief. How it works is beyond belief. So if I explain it to you, if you try to understand it through belief, you can't understand it. You will not be able to accept it. No way. No possible way. Because belief simply is born of the quote-unquote necessity to survive annihilation. So the idea of simply giving up any attempt to survive annihilation is incomprehensible to belief. But it's totally comprehensible to reality. Totally comprehensible. And reality, that's exactly what reality is asking us, to give up this hypothetical, because it's totally unnecessary. There'll never be reality will never be threatened or annihilated. Impossible. So it's completely crazy, quixotic journey we've been on, meaningless. So we don't need problems to come into our life. We don't need it at all. And yet success is based on tackling problems in our lives. And so what happened was I lost that ability to tackle problems, mainly because I was tackling the entire problem of problems and the whole situation as one. I was tackling that. And so I look at people, and people I used to have way higher status than now were way above me. And really, that was incredibly difficult. You talk about eating crow and being humbled. It just, every day, every minute of every day, you're just saying, oh my God. You see the world going by, and they're all superior to you. And this is simply a fact. It's not like you're depressed and you think maybe just because your mood is down that you're thinking people are. But no, it's a fact. It's a fact. Because I'm not successful solving problems anymore. The motivation isn't there. The drive, everything that you need to do that, is deteriorated to such an extreme extent that I literally could not compete. Could not compete, could not keep up, could not. And so I've been dwelling on this low, 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 low spot for a long time now, and can't get out of it. Cannot get, and as far as succeeding in the worldly way, there's no possibility I can. No way I'll ever be able to reprise that role here in this world. That role is lost to me. And that's a tough thing to deal with, I'm telling you. I'm still struggling with it a little bit, because there's something in me that wants to succeed, to show the world that I can succeed, and that I'm not this, that all this was just a fluke or something. But belief will never understand it. It'll just say, how did anyone suddenly rocket up like that? And they'll just say, it's just a crazy anomaly. There's no way to explain it, and just move on, forget about it, don't even think about it. It's just so it's a issue I'm looking at and need to look at. And the final step is to finally trade in all your everything, your entire problem solving apparatus. Let it go. Drop it. And when once that is done, it's replaced with the grace of God, which is infinite, which is your life becomes totally blessed at that point. Totally blessed. You can do no wrong. You can do no wrong. It's just whatever you do, everything just works out in the maximally favorable way. That's what will happen. And people will not know what to make of it at all. And people that know me now, I don't know how they can possibly accept it. I really don't. I may need to go away on a vacation or something. God's grace will have to arrange a vacation for me, because I can't go on a vacation. I'm so low in status, I can't do anything. Can't go anywhere, can't do anything. Can't even buy anything. Except the bare necessities. And even that's getting rough. So, but a vacation maybe it would allow me to make a transition and then come back seemingly different. People say, wow, you sure have changed a lot. And they just won't be able to relate to me the way I am now at all. Because in their eyes, I'm just some extremely low status person. And imagine the fall, you know, from someone who was looked at as maybe capable of providing a profound breakthrough for the world as far as solving problems, as someone who had the capability of extreme status as far as problem solving, going down to the very bottom, who people feel I have no capacity to solve problems whatsoever. They just look at me as just like a simpleton who has no value whatsoever. To go in one life to do that, just to plummet like that. That's, I say my life has been intense. That is just an example of how intense it's been. And in part of my job, there's some people who are kind of perceptive, and they look at me and they say, what in the world are you doing here? I say, you don't belong here at all. You absolutely do not fit here at all. I mean, there's something about you which... It's just, I says, I don't understand it. I really don't understand it. And I said, well, yeah, I don't understand it either. Why I'm, it's like a catfish, you know, you're down there with the catfish, and the catfish are bottom feeders, and you're a trout or something, and you go down to the bottom, and the catfish say, what in the world are you doing down here? You're not supposed to be down here. Something's wrong. You know, something's not right. Why are you here? I said, I don't know. I just got pushed down here. It's really strange. And so that's the one area I've not been able to quite come to terms with. How do I deal with the sudden shift in status where... just will rock it up to some incredible position. Not even a position in society at all, or just people just won't even know what to say. Because my life will be completely blessed. I've seen that. There's no question. I always know that would happen, but now I'm so close to that. It's like, wow, I don't know. I'm not quite sure. It is just, don't know what to say. I mean, I know why, perfectly. I can't explain to anyone else, though. Hardly. Maybe a few. Maybe a few will be interested. But the whole issue of God's grace is something that people don't understand. They really don't. They really don't understand. I do. I understand it now, finally. I always knew it was there, I just didn't know how to access it, but now I'm seeing how to access it, actually. That's part of the clarity I was having. It's like, wow, I can access this now. Wow. Holy cow. You know, it's just... slaving your life away in some dark mine, trying to find a gold nugget, and suddenly you look up and there's a whole mountain of gold there. Pure gold, perfect gold. And you have perfect access to it. What do you say? It's really beyond words. It's really beyond belief. Belief can't believe it. So, you know, belief, people won't be able to believe it. Because belief cannot believe it. It cannot. It will not be able to believe it. So I don't know what belief will do. I really don't know. It will probably ask questions and try to understand it, but it won't be able to. But some will some will notice something. Just like I noticed in Ananamaima, I simply noticed something. I can't say what noticed it. Not belief. Belief didn't know. There's something beyond belief. I noticed something. I said, hey, what's this? And it's like, boom, caught my attention. Wait, what's going on here? This is beyond belief. That was my reaction. I said, wait a minute, this is beyond belief. This is totally beyond belief here. What is this? And so those who are ready to go beyond belief will notice something. There's some kind of blessing here. What is this blessing? It's like an incredible blessing is here. Well, where did that come from? How could that happen? It's like, wow, what? And there's just like, you just accept it. There's something in you that says, I accept this. For me, like seeing Ananamaima videos of her and pictures, I just accepted it. I said, I accept this. I accept it. But it is beyond belief. And therefore, I accept what is beyond belief. I know there's something beyond belief because here it is, and I accept it. I know I can accept it for myself. I know I can. It's just a matter of getting to that point of really accepting it for myself, as each one of you must do. You must accept it for yourself. You must accept God's grace for yourself. And in the truest sense, in a real sense, not some dogmatic sense, no, in a real sense, meaning literally, that your problems wiped away forever. Forever. And goodbye fear, goodbye threat, goodbye vulnerability, goodbye annihilation, goodbye struggle, scarcity, strife, unhappiness, depression, misery, despair, confusion, fatigue, everything. Goodbye forever. And that is literally what I'm on the brink of right now. And so it's like, I'll just accept that as it is. Just accept it as it is. Okay, how's it going to play out? Just some patience and let it play out. Let it play out. Let your path play out. Because literally you're going towards something that is beyond belief. How can belief believe that we can truly have the all wiped clean like that forever? How can belief believe that? Because it says, well, we haven't solved the problem of annihilation yet, so how can you possibly be free? Because the problem of annihilation doesn't need to be solved, because it's not a problem. It's not a real problem. That's why. It will never be a real problem. So we don't need a real answer, do we? And if we don't need a real answer, what are we doing? What are we doing? We're coming up with make-believe answers. Why do we need that? All our suffering is wrapped up in these make-believe answers. Our struggle for a make-believe answer, we don't need any of that. Nobody does. The problem is, I'm trying to see what the problem is. The issue is that most people will say, well, I don't believe I can reach this exalted level. And so it's just, I just don't see it's worth trying because I can't do it. But remember, it's belief that says it can't do it, because it believes that it needs to first find the answer to annihilation and then be deserving of this. Not true. There is no real problem of annihilation. There is no real answer to it. So you'll never succeed at that. You're deserving right now because you're a child of reality, and reality is as it is right now. So you're deserving right now. But few see that. Few see it that way. So you cannot really save everybody right now. It's not possible, because most people are too engaged with the problem solving of belief and too wrapped up in that. They'll simply say, I don't deserve anything so exalted. And yet, if I don't accept it, I will be useless to those who can truly be helped. Really useless, because they need certitude. You need to be helpful. You have to convey certitude. To be a genuine teacher, you have to convey 100% certitude. No doubt about it, certitude. Otherwise, it is merely someone helping, walking along with you on the path, giving you some reassurance and pep talks and stuff. But it doesn't really give you the big boost that enables you to get past the tricky obstacles. The tricky obstacles, I see the tricky obstacles remain. They remained for the unless you have that certitude, which I was fortunate enough to get in a number of different ways, then those obstacles, you simply say, well, I can't get past those obstacles. Not possible. This life, I can't do it. I have to go through another annihilation event, and I need to work at it more, et cetera, which is all complete mistake. You won't have that feeling of certitude that you know you're going to make it, and you just don't know how, but somehow you're going to make it. So I had precognition I was going to make it this lifetime. I knew I was going to make it. So it's just a matter of how, just a matter of letting it play out and getting there. But I never for once thought that I wouldn't make it. Never once. I just didn't know how. I said, how did I get rid of those obstacles? It seems so difficult. I knew I would do it, but just like, how am I going to do this? It just seems really so obscure. How do you get rid of problems? You get rid of problems by accepting you don't need to get rid of them. Plain and simple. That's the answer. And it seems like a total paradox, doesn't it? Again, how do you get rid of those problems that seem to just be so difficult and so problematic? You get rid of them by realizing you don't need to get rid of them. That's how you do it. You don't need to solve them. Because you just realize you don't need the problems. You don't need to solve them. Because reality already is what it is and always will be. So these problems don't need to be solved. You recognize the nature of the problems you're trying to solve are hypothetical. That is how you free yourself from them. You have to recognize they're hypothetical. If you see them as real, you are stuck. And there's nothing is going to succeed then at that point. You have to take the approach that will eventually see them as hypothetical. Now, somehow the non-dual approach manages to do this in some way. For those who simply, I don't know exactly how they're able to do that. It's pretty amazing. But for me, I don't have to do it that way. Because I literally can see that they're hypothetical. I see the whole ideology and origin of it all. And so for me, it's just blatantly clear it's hypothetical. Doesn't have to be solved. That's how they're solved. You don't solve them. Your problem is you're trying to solve problems that can't be solved and don't need to be solved. That is the problem. So just give up trying to solve them, and you're free. Plain and simple. Give up trying to what can't be solved and doesn't need to be solved, and you're free. Free, free. And I'm having these deep releases of intense grief over and over and over again. Many instances of that. And last night I had a very strong one again. Good grief. And that may be just loosening up the inner vehicles, as it were, from the intense terror, horror that they vibrate at. The threat of annihilation is what drives existence. The threat of annihilation is what drives existence. That's not a sport of God. That is not a play of God. God is not playing at being annihilated. That is nonsense. It's just nonsense. It's totally brutal to us to say that there's nobody experiencing it. No, that's nonsense. We are experiencing it. We absolutely are. And we need to get free of that experiencing. We are experiencing fear. We are experiencing fear. Terrible fear. That's our experience. And there is an experiencer of fear. We can't keep playing word games. We are experiencing fear. The false self is the one that's supposedly going to overcome the experiencing of fear. You don't need the false self to overcome the experiencing of fear to find a way to cure, to have the feel the fear and not be bothered by it. You don't have to have that happen at all. You don't need to do anything at all with this dream. No resolution, no problem solving, no outcome. You don't need any outcome. don't need any outcome to take place whatsoever. You can drop any effort to obtain any outcome. And then the grace of God is there to provide all the outcomes that are not only blissful for you and beautiful, but beautiful and blissful for others too. And then your whole life gets lit up like a Christmas tree, where everyone you come in contact with and touch, and everyone even in the world in subtle ways, gets blessed simply by you being here, just without you doing anything. Nanda Maima said, you never did anything. People say, you're doing so much. He goes, what are you talking about? I'm not doing anything. It's God's grace that's doing everything. She never did anything. Just enjoyed. Just had a fabulously wonderful time. Just, but as far as struggling and doing, she said, I didn't do anything. This is all the grace of God at work here. So life becomes truly effortless, and just you feel this just like you're. I can barely imagine it. I can hardly describe it. It's just, and that's not necessary. It's not necessary. What is necessary is to see that you don't have to solve any problems. The way to get free of problems is to recognize they're all hypothetical, and you don't need to come up with an answer for them. You don't need to resolve them. You don't need to adapt to them. You don't need to get rid of them. You don't need to do anything at all. No answer is needed. You get rid of the problem by realizing you don't need to get rid of the problem. And then seeing that crystal clear and accepting it. And then dropping all efforts in your vehicles to be problem solving. I believe that's probably what's taking place on the inner planes with me, is that the inner vehicles, subtler vehicles, are being purified, have been purified, and at some point then this physical vehicle will take on some sort of purification or appear to be very purified or something like that. I don't know. I really don't know, but we'll progressively take on some sort of very graceful demeanor or something along those lines. I don't know. The people will just say, "Huh? Why? You know, what is that's different? That's very different. Very different. Don't come across that." They'll say, "Why? I don't know if I've ever come across something like this. What is this? This is a different bird of a different feather entirely. What is that?" What is that? And then some will say, whoa, wait a minute. There's something here, something going on. I got to really pay attention beyond belief, have that full kind of deep attention. Let me see if I can tune into this, really tune into it. Some will do that. But I won't be trying to solve anyone's problems, simply giving assurance that problems don't need to be solved at all. At all. Nobody's problems need to be solved. Never. It means we don't need any cures for any diseases. We don't need to come up with any cures for anything. We don't need to come up with cures for mental disease. We don't need to come up with any survival tactics at all. Nothing. We don't even need to come up with this world as a staging for all this. We don't even need to come up with this universe as a staging for all this. We don't need to come up with any answers for our lives whatsoever. None. Zero. And we need to drop even the effort to come up with any problems. Remember, the etiology of this is to solve a problem of annihilation, but the desire to solve this problem is really primary. It is more primary. Just for instance, the desire to survive annihilation gives rise to a symbol of annihilation. So we want to cure things. We want to resolve problems. That gives rise to the problems. If we give up any desire to solve any problems, no problems will arise for us. And then grace of God takes over at that point. And if we don't see what the grace of God is about, we won't trust this. We will not trust it. So that is pretty much the spiritual path. We need to see what the grace of God is really about, what miracles are really about. And it's beyond belief. And that's another problem. It is literally beyond belief how it can work. Because from God's standpoint, there are no problems. So God can literally grace of God can literally arrange anything that needs to be arranged. People will start just giving you stuff. I don't know how that's possible. I said, I don't deserve this. What do you mean? I didn't do anything to deserve this. No. And I know my mom, people are just constantly giving her stuff as fast, and she just like constantly giving away as fast as possible. People just give her stuff. She didn't, you know, what she doing? What did she do to deserve any of that? They said, no, I want to give you this. I'll give you this. That's the grace of God at work. Is people just spontaneously will just give you stuff. And so that's why people say, you're the luckiest person in the world, the most fortunate person in the world. Everybody just gives you stuff. How is that possible? I mean, what did you do? You know, to earn that or something? And that's why the whole thing of like supposedly good karma. Karma just comes from belief, because that's a way of belief trying to explain it. Trying to explain this good fortune of those who have stopped trying to solve problems. How come they're getting stuff? And the belief says, oh, well, they earned it in a previous life. That's why they're getting all this good karma. Not true. That's a lie. Because Ananda Mayama had no karma. She said she never, ever identified with the problem of annihilation, trying to solve this problem, hypothetical. She never did it. She knew, never. She always has known that such a thing is completely impossible. The notion never even arose in her at all. So she didn't come into this world due to any karma whatsoever. So why then was everybody giving her everything? It couldn't be from good karma. It's not possible. She said she didn't have any. None. So that explanation completely breaks down then. And you see that it's an explanation coming from belief. Karma is an explanation coming from belief. What happens is people give you stuff because the grace of God is working through them, and it's for their own benefit. It's for their own benefit down the road that they do these things, and that God is orchestrating, the grace of God orchestrates the entire situation, so down the road in the big picture, everything they're doing is being beneficial in some way. They won't even know why they do it. They say, I don't know, I just felt like this is the right thing to do, and I just want to do this. And trying to put it together is not possible, because the past is so convoluted, because a belief makes it super convoluted. But in some way, it will turn out to be of great benefit to them at some point on their own spiritual path. So in the willingness to accept all this super good fortune, I'm actually... I will be helping people out immensely, because most people won't accept gifts like that. They'll say, oh, wait, oh, no, wait, I didn't do anything to deserve this. This is too much good fortune. I don't want this. They start feeling like they're accruing karma. If you accept it, like if you accept, you know, all these great gifts, you think, well, I got to pay it back at some point. I got all this karma. See? But that is not true at all. You're not, once you give up trying solving problems and drop it, all that whole hypothetical, and accept the grace of God, you're not in karma at all, because karma is only within belief, which is, it's just a false notion. You don't accrue any karma at all. None. So all this good fortune doesn't mean you have to pay anything back, ever. Not. It's for the benefit of everyone, and it's up to God, the grace of God, to know all of that, to know how it's going to be beneficial. So, it's going to be a whole new ball game for me, for sure. That is for sure. I've gone through a time where it seemed like nothing works and nothing comes to me, and just unbelievable, but all for my benefit, actually, because I needed to see through the whole situation, and sometimes suffering helps in that way. Having nothing go your way, it just seems like, oh gosh, how come good karma is not working for me? Well, you're able to look at karma as a whole, and then I saw through it and said, there's no such thing as karma. It's all delusion. But if I had been getting quote-unquote good karma, I would have said, hey, I'm going to try to figure out how to earn more good karma. And I wouldn't have had the appropriate depth to see through it all. So if you are going through a situation, somewhere in mind, where you've lost status, social status, really. You've lost it, and you feel the good luck, good karma, all that stuff is not going your way anymore. Don't despair. Turn it to your advantage and try to see through the whole charade of existence, of this hypothetical scenario, trying to figure out a way to survive annihilation. Keep trying, then hang in there and see it that way, because you will make the big breakthrough, which is what I have done, really. I mean, I can't characterize it any other way. What I've seen is such a colossal breakthrough. I just have to say it is total breakthrough, as it were, really. Sure, I can make more and more and more recognize it, but essentially, it's essentially a breakthrough, And that comes about by being pressured to say, wait a minute, things aren't working the way I thought they were supposed to work. Why? And then recognizing the whole thing is you don't have to solve any problems at all. And so you don't have to accrue good karma. The grace of God is perfectly sufficient to give you a perfect ride home. It's like you stop driving and you're now a passenger, and your ride home is just fabulous. And it's fabulous beyond belief. And those who are still stuck in belief, there's no way they can understand it. You can't imagine it. But there is a way to accept it. It's all about acceptance. It's all about acceptance. It's all about seeing you deserve it. So acceptance, meaning deserving, plays into acceptance. If you don't believe if you don't see yourself as deserving it, you won't accept it. You won't accept it. And for me, stumbling block is saying, well, I'm on the bottom kind of now, and how can I accept great good fortune from being on the bottom? It seems to upset the order of how things work in existence, right? It does accept the order of it. No question about that. That's for me, it feels like the final stumbling block is there won't seem to be a logical order to it. It'll seem to be miraculous. And it's sort of like upsets the apple cart of existence. But it needs to be upset. The apple cart of existence needs to be upset. And I guess I'll just leave it at that. That's a beautiful way of looking at it. Yeah, it does upset the apple cart, but the apple cart does need to be upset, because that's profoundly helpful. Because each one of you will need to upset the apple cart too. You'll need to accept the grace of God, which will completely upset the apple cart of existence. And you'll just be in this flawless bliss, and with causeless from the standpoint of existence. It'll seem causeless. It's not causeless. Reality's causing it. But existence is insisting that it's reality, and so it has to cause it. So it'll just say, wow, we got to discover the cause of this. Where is it coming from? And they'll just scratch their heads, and you keep on doing what you're doing, and that just seemed to be nonplussed and baffling. That upsets the apple cart of existence. And I found I was fine with that in studying the life of Ananda Maima and seeing how she upset the apple cart of existence to such an incredible degree. I felt perfectly fine with it. It's like, yeah, that's what I want. That's exactly what I want. I want the apple cart existence to be overturned. And it didn't. I felt like a duck taking the water in that, saying, yeah, that's great. So just let everything happen. Whatever happens, just accept it. Let it happen. Let it all happen. And yet some will say, well, he didn't explain anything. So there's no teacher there. No explanation. No big book explaining how is it that all these things were happening. What did he do to make it happen? No, it's just happening through God's grace. There's no book that needs to be written. You can say some stuff, sure, but as far as from the standpoint of belief, you can't explain it to the satisfaction of belief at all. So belief will just say, oh, there's nothing here. Ah, what a disappointment. No, no. We thought there was something great here, but it turned out to be nothing there. That's how belief will take it. Which is why so many people have forgotten Ananda Mahima. Because they say, it seemed like something very promising, but it turned out to be nothing. Nothing at all there. Well, but she's the patron saint of apple cart upsetters. That is for sure. That is for sure. She's been my patron saint, really. Really. Remains that. Because she is the patron saint of apple cart upsetters. Because she did it in recently, in the 20th century, during most of the 20th century, and was just completely profound at doing it. And those who know about, those who are able to recognize this, they recognize it and said, holy cow, this is just off the charts. So, patron saint of apple cart upsetters. And so I bow to that. I bow to that because it's factual. I bow to facts. I bow to facts. I bow to truth. And that's what really works here. Because God's grace is what works for you. And it will seem to be upsetting the apple cart here. There's no two ways around it. I tried to please both belief and grace. You can't do it. You can't do it. Belief will tell you to slow down. Say, whoa, 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 whoa. Stop, 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 stop. You got to explain to me, how in the world, you know, did this happen? But grace is happening so fast. Boom, 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 boom. You can't say, whoa, 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 slow down, stop. Because it's flowing. Its very nature is flowing, overflowingness. Ananda Mahima means the overflowing bliss, that which is overflowing with bliss. It's overflowingness. That's its nature. You cannot, it's a mountain of gold. And the belief says, whoa, 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 stop. How'd you get that little nugget of gold? How'd you do that? It's a wrong question. The supposition of the question is false. You didn't get a little nugget of gold. You got a whole mountain of gold. So you can't, answering that question of belief is not possible. It's stupid. You can't engage stupidity. You can't engage belief like that. It's completely stupid. Because then the whole situation gets off the tracks, because now you're talking about a little nugget, and the supposition is you have a little nugget. And how did you get that little nugget? And then all your explanations will be a wrong foundation, wrong premise. So you just have to let everything happen. You just have to let all the miracles happen. Don't try to stop them from happening. And it's not that when someone says you're great, well, we all are. We're all equally great. We're all children of reality, and all reality is one with all of reality. So all the greatness of reality is equally shared by every aspect of reality. So we're all equally great. What is great is that fact. And the play of that fact in this world is great. It's the play of that fact that in the world is great. It's not my play or your play. It both is and it isn't. Because we are all one, so it is my play and it is your play. And it's everyone's play. And it's also no one's play in particular. And yet it seems that way. It might seem that way, like it's my play. That plays miracles is my play, but it's not. It's not. Well, it is and it isn't. It seems that way within the hypothetical, but from the standpoint of reality, it is simply the play of reality at play. It is reality at play in the hypothetical. It seems like grace. Not solving the problems of the hypothetical per se, but dancing in such a way that it helps us gravitate towards recognizing we don't need to solve the problems of the hypothetical. So it's very paradoxical and beyond belief's grasp. Belief can't grasp it. How does it dance this way? It dances in a certain way that allows us to realize we don't need to dance with problems. It dances with problems to help us see we don't need to dance with problems. And it's sort of a deep recognition that grace is at play, but not in the way that belief explains it. That's why I take issue with the way that belief explains it. It's all wrong. Everything that belief explains is wrong, totally wrong. And yet, almost all spiritual teaching in the world is the explanations of belief. Not all. But as far as what the world is taking in, almost all of it is they're taking in is comes from belief. It's all just completely insane, completely mistaken. And yet, the grace of God dances with that too. Dances with that also. Knowing that it's not so. It's like dancing with nothing. But somehow grace of God can do that. Can act like it's dancing with something. And you say, oh, the way it dances, you think it's dancing with something. It's not dancing with anything. And yet it appears to be dancing with something. Seems that way. And eventually, I guess there's some point, realize it wasn't dancing with anything. But symbolically, it will seem that way. So I'm just, as far as insights go, I've nailed it. I've really nailed it. I gave myself an A plus. But then there's this issue of allowing the grace of God to do its play. Then that becomes the next issue that I'm looking at. I don't really feel much need to look at the theory of it all so much anymore. It's just pretty easy for me. If I look at just the whole thing, just falls apart and seen through. So that's not an issue anymore. The issue is allowing this play to dance, and people will say like, oh, you're so great, or others will say, oh, how come you're not explaining this, or all these different things coming at you, and you just have to let it dance. And allowing the dance to just dance, allowing it to just take place, and just hang out with it. It's not really my dance, so to speak. Not this persona, not this appearance. It's not this appearance's dance at all. It's just, this is a reference point, is all. It's the idea of hanging out with it. In other words, if I hang out with it, that gives you the idea of hanging out with it. That's really what it is. Because that's ultimately what you need to do, is simply to hang out with this dance of grace. Hang out with accepting reality as it is, just to hang out with it. That's all. So if I hang out with it, then that gives you the idea, hey, well, maybe I can hang out with it too. That's what I saw in Ananda Maima. I said, she's hanging out with perfect grace. No question in my mind. I saw it clear as a bell. I said, maybe I can do it. And then people ask her, can we do this? She said, of course you can. In fact, you all will have to do this. Same with Jesus. He said, you must all do this too. You absolutely. So she's just hanging out with perfect grace. Hanging out with it perfectly. I said, oh, wow, that's what I want to do. Just hang out with God's grace. And so that's all that anyone is doing in this world. Any teacher, that's all they're doing. They're just hanging out with God's grace. And just enjoying it. That's all. That's it. Nothing more. Nothing more. They're not trying to solve any problems. They don't need to. There aren't any real problems to solve. And of course, those who believe that these problems are real are trying to find real answers to them, and they're struggling mightily. And what they need to see is there aren't any real problems. And the more you see it this way, the closer you get towards freedom from this, dropping this hypothetical scenario altogether. And then you really won't have any problems at all. And you realize nobody else has any real problems either. Although it seems to them that they have hypothetical problems for sure. They have terrible hypothetical problems, no question about it. I'm not here to tell you you're not suffering. You are. You're suffering horribly. If you're having this experience of fear, terrible fear, absolutely. That's horrendous, worse than you know. Of course, I'm not... The way at all, saying, oh no, nobody suffers. Of course you're suffering horribly. But the basis of the suffering is not real. In other words, you don't have to suffer. You can drop the suffering this instant. That's what I mean, without the necessity of solving anything whatsoever. And you say, what about solving the problem of suffering? That is the solving of the problem of suffering. Is the basis of the fear of annihilation is false. There is no such thing as annihilation. Therefore, there is no basis to be afraid of it. Therefore, you don't need any fear. You don't need fear. Fear, then, no more. And therefore, your suffering is over. Very, very clear. Very simple for me now. So the challenge now is to accept the grace of God. That's my challenge. My challenge is not for me to try and clarify. It's already simple for me. It's like riding a bike. I get on the bike, I can ride it. It's just allowing this incredible play of God's grace, just hanging out with this play of God's grace. I'll probably just be wonderstruck by it. But that's okay. I'm pretty good at that. Pretty good at being wonderstruck and just be accepting that. So, should be a pretty great time had by all. I don't know how it's going to play out, whether this will be the better story, the better news event, the better celebration, the better locale, whether this will be it or it'll come about some other way. Maybe it'll come about here. I don't know. I don't know the timing on it. Really, it is super difficult to know the timing on your spiritual path. I mean, I've tried many times to pin it down and it's wrong every time. So I always expect it's going to be soon. Always. It has never been soon. Never been soon. So again, I expect it to be soon. It might not be soon at all. I realize there's really no way for me to tell. Theoretically, it could be tomorrow. Or not. It could be any day or not. And maybe it'll be a slow play. It'll start out just a trickle or something. I don't know. Possible. Probably. I mean, just from the practical standpoint, in this world, it's so difficult to get anything done. It's, wow. You have so many hoops you have to jump through. It's just amazing. Growing exponentially constantly. But there again, that's not my problem. That's the grace of God that has to deal with all that stuff. So I just be a passenger. And maybe I can be a really good passenger right off the bat. That is possible. Maybe I can hang out with grace of God really well from the get-go. And then that will be really helpful. Super helpful. So, all right. Managed to beat the cold temperatures out here, but I better not stay too long. I might get into me too much. So, if you look at it from this perspective, I'm looking at it, it's pretty interesting situation, really. And it's worth hanging in there. It's worth hanging in there for everyone at this time. It's worth hanging in there. There's something going on in the world. Just my own path is so incredible, really. Just what happens, I never know from day to day. It's just like, wow. We don't know. Something really great could very helpful could happen in the world. Really, hang in there. This is totally serious. I'm speaking 100% from the heart, saying, hang in there. Do not give up on your true potential, which is to hang out with accepting reality as it is. You do have that potential. We all do. We do have that. I mean, I know someone who did hang out with Ananamaima as a child. A lot. And she really didn't understand. She didn't really grasp what was going on exactly. But she did it. She did it. She did it, literally. She did it. So she's a link, and she knows thousands and thousands of people who did it. It's really important to know that fact. And we can do it. We absolutely can do it. And we'll do it. So if that's the case, we gotta hang in there. Right? Absolutely have to. Okay. Very great. That's it for this one.